Okay, well, thanks very much for having me here. It's really an honor to be able to give this lecture. I'll try and get at the right level, but don't be afraid to ask questions as we go along if there's something I say you don't understand. So I think I would agree with that. I think we're in an incredible time where there's really a revolution going on because you can collect data on people at a level that's never been possible before. So we can sequence all your DNA, and I'll explain what that means in a minute. But we can do more than that. We can actually literally make thousands, if not billions, of measurements on people. And my own view is that this is going to revolutionize the way health is managed, and we're going to shift, quite frankly, from treating people after they get disease to try and actually understand health and keep people healthy. That's really where I think we're going. So I'm going to give you, some science. I'll give you some personal story. You'll hear about my experience. You'll also hear plenty of editorial comments about my opinions about this whole area. So I think this area in general, I like to call it personalized medicine because I do really think it is more personal than precise. We're a long ways from precise, but these are almost used synonymously. Anyway, President Obama, many of you may know, a little over a year ago announced this precision medicine initiative, which is intended to, it's not 100% clear what it's going to do, but it's going to study a million people, probably sequence all their DNA and other things. And basically it's probably going to be a multi-billion-dollar initiative. And then you just heard in January this year, there's a moonshot on cancer, and that's probably another billion-dollar initiative. So you can see this $1 billion initiative from precision medicine with another $1 billion from cancer, and I think there's just going to be a wealth of activity going on in this area. Billion-dollar initiatives colliding, so to speak. This is really what frames our thinking about this area, and this is intuitive, as you'll see in a minute, but I actually think we're going to try and take this much further. So the idea, at least the way we like to think about it, is health as a state. You're healthy, hopefully most of the time, but occasionally you do get sick from simple things like viral infections to maybe not so simple things like cancer or various complex diseases, and you toggle between these states. What makes this happen is the influence of many different factors, if you will, many different things. One is your DNA and your collection of DNA. You probably know what you call your genome. But it's all the other things you're exposed to, and that's often called your exposome. So meaning the pathogens you might be exposed to, viruses and bacteria, possible stresses that you might encounter. I know that doesn't happen in Bozeman. It's very stress-free for you. The food you eat very much influences your health state. And exercise affects your health in an incredible fashion, actually. We're learning this in molecular terms. So we know this intuitively, but I would argue that we want to know this beyond that. We want to know this in quantitative terms. Because I'm a believer in the not-so-distant future, people will be getting born with their genomes already sequenced, because you can do that now in the mom, in the pregnant mother. And then with that information, you will want to know what kinds of exposures might lead to what kinds of health outcomes. Just as an obvious example, if you're at high risk for Parkinson's, you shouldn't be a pesticide worker. You might argue maybe you should never be a pesticide worker, but certainly if you're at risk for Parkinson's, you definitely don't want to be, because that actually has very strong genetic and environmental impact. And that's the kind of thing we'd like to learn at a level that goes way beyond what I just said. And so we want to understand this, I would argue, in quantitative terms. And these won't be completely deterministic. They'll be what you call probabilistic. That is, those increased chance these things will happen. Again, they won't be absolutely determinist, but they will happen in some quantitative fashion. So just by way of background, many of you may know this already, but we all start out as a single cell, and then we develop into a $10 trillion organism, and this is both genetic and probably a lot of environmental influence, things as well. And as you know, we all don't come out unique. We all do come out unique. And our DNA, you probably know, it's a string of four chemicals, four letters, if you will, and they're put together in a particular order, and we have 6 billion bases of these. It's packaged into something called chromosomes, and we have 46 of these, 23 from our mom, 23 from our dad, And this really is our genetic information. It's packaged like this. It's a string. I've only shown one string. You actually have two coming together. And really, when you're sequencing DNA, you're trying to determine the order of these particular letters. And for the most part, they're the same amongst most people, but they do differ. They differ roughly about one in every 1,200 bases or so. Ooh, so maybe we could turn down just a touch on the slides. And we have all kinds of differences between us. We call these variants. So meaning you can have single letter changes, if you will, the G going to a T and vice versa. And we have a lot of these. We have, because we have 6 billion bases, we have 4 million of these. Actually makes the difference between you and the person sitting next to you. We also have lots of actually fairly short insertions and deletions. I call these indels, things like this. We have mini deletions, if you will, and expansions. And there's typically about 500,000, although the exact number has not been mapped. And then we also have actually big changes. Believe it or not, you can have a million bases, a million of these letters in a row that will actually differ between you and the person sitting next to you. Certainly there are multiple ones of a few hundreds of thousands of these letters that will change. These are called structural variants or covenants. But collectively, these changes actually make differences between people so that we all don't look alike. So this is Yao Ming, the basketball player, and this is a guy named Steve who put his picture up with Yao on the internet. See, they're not identical. So again, we differ from one another by these both single base and larger changes that occur. So person one will have a certain DNA sequence with certain letters and a few spots, and then others will differ by others. You actually can figure this out because you can sequence people's DNA now. We won't get into the details of this, and you find these changes relative to a reference sequence that was actually determined initially in 2001, more complete form in 2003. But basically, you're trying to find these changes relative to reference and understand your genetic code. So many of you may know there's been a revolution in DNA technologies. It started in the mid-2000s, and actually the price of genome sequencing has dropped considerably. So the first genome cost somewhere between $500 million and $1 billion to determine. But with new technologies that have come out starting in the middle of the last decade, the price has dropped just amazingly. It's dropped actually about tenfold every 15 months or so. Maybe not quite as fast in the last few years because there's not as much competition, and I think that slowed things down a little bit. But it's at the point where we pay now $1,200 to get a genome sequence. Okay, that's just the sequencing cost. The interpretation, mind you, costs $15,000 for a healthy person. That will drop in the future. There are reasons why that's expensive now. There's a lot of manual labor involved, which will gradually go away. But the point is, this is now getting very affordable, and probably, quite frankly, this will hit a few hundred dollars in the not-so-distant future. So the point is that all of you will have the option of getting your genome sequence. And so the question isn't, you know, whether you can get your genome sequence, it's whether you want to get your genome sequence. And just out of curiosity, A, how many of you have had your genome or the coding sequences sequenced so far? Quite a few, gosh, that's amazing. SNPs, okay, SNPs. Yeah, and then how many want to get their genome sequenced? Okay, quite a few, a lot in the front. How many don't want to get their genome sequenced? Quite a few, yeah, and how many don't know? Okay. So, all right. There's no right answer for this, mind you. That is to say, if you're worried, you probably don't want to get your genome sequenced because you will see things that will suggest you're at risk for things. But although I would argue you should get your genome sequence, just not get all that information returned to you. You let the obvious things return. You'll see why in a little bit. But again, it is a personal decision. And you might see as we go through this lecture, if you will, whether that influences whether you do or don't want to get your genome sequence. Usually I have zero effect on that, you know, whether you want to or don't want to, and that's okay. All right. But at least you should think about it because all of you will have the option of getting your genome sequence. All right. Now, because it's gotten fairly cheap, like quite a few people have had their genome sequence. These are some of the first two. This is Jim Watson, who worked on the structure of DNA, along with Francis Crick. This is a person with a rather large ego and a large picture, I guess. also got the genome sequence early. But you know, here's Ozzy Osbourne and Glenn Close. All these people have had their genome sequence. In fact, there's now a million genome sequences. This year, we crossed the million genome mark just very recently, where either whole genome or the coding sequence called the exomes have been sequenced. Okay, because it is getting fairly cheaper and easy to do this, it's actually having an enormous impact in medicine. We're gonna spend quite a bit of time on this. So it's really revolutionizing medicine in many ways. Many of you may have heard about some of this. So basically, you can understand and treat disease, and I'll walk through some of this in a minute, but cancer is probably one of the highest impact areas where genome sequencing is having an effect. Solving mystery diseases is also very common. And actually, prenatal diagnosis, I won't say much about this, but you may know that in a pregnant woman, the fetal DNA actually starts, probably very early, but by 5 or 6 weeks, there's something on the order of 3 to 4% of the DNA circulating in the blood of the mom, actually belongs to the fetus, and that actually increases somewhere up to about 10, maybe 12%, some people say 14% by birth. And so you can actually harvest the DNA from the blood during a routine blood test and sequence it and actually figure out some genetic defects that could be there in the fetus. And in particular, there are now LET tests, they're called. There are companies that are selling tests for aneuploidy of chromosome 21, 13, and 18. So three of the more common aneuploidies, and 21 is Down syndrome, for those of you who follow this sort of thing, and actually Renee is the world's expert in these sorts of aneuploidies. And anyway, you can do this, and in fact, it used to be people did amniocentesis, you may have heard of this, where you pull it from, you know, the sac, which has a certain risk. Now that's virtually all but obliterated. In fact, there were a million of these tests run in 2014, and I don't know how many it is in 2015, but it's more, and you'd almost be crazy to do amniocentesis, because this is a higher specificity and sensitivity than amniocentesis does. You might confirm that way. But the point is that this is revolutionizing, and it's also possible, though not run as a test, to actually determine the entire genome sequence from the blood of the fetus, from the blood of the mom, of the pregnant woman. So that's why I do think this will turn into a test that raises all kinds of issues, which we can talk about in the question and answer. I won't talk much about this today, but I guarantee if you don't learn anything from your genome sequence, you'll learn something about your drug sensitivity. That's what pharmacogenomics means. And typically, there's about a half a dozen drugs you might learn something important about. So in my case, you'll see in a minute, I have type 2 diabetes, so the top two things on my list tell me drug sensitivity to common diabetes drugs. So I have information about warfarin and a few other drugs that are useful to know. Hopefully I'll never need them, but if I do, my genome tells me which statins. I'm on statins. My genome tells me which statins to avoid, actually. I might get bad side effects. Here's the area that interests us a lot. Well, what if you're healthy? Can genome sequencing be very valuable to you? And that's what we'll talk about in a little bit. So let's just go through a few of these. Cancer, you probably know it's a genetic disease. You can have cancer running in your family, so meaning it's heritable. There's some mutations in your family that are actually causing high frequency of cancer, and there are famous mutations like BRCA that are responsible. There are a lot that haven't been discovered yet. It's also what's called a somatic disease, meaning some of these genetic changes occur, almost guarantee they occur, as cancer forms and starts growing and dividing, you get all kinds of genetic changes that cause cells to grow uncontrollably. And it depends on the cancer and the particular individual, but there's on the order possibly up to 10 to 20 so-called driver mutations, genetic mutations that are actually causing these cells to grow uncontrollably. What we've learned by now sequencing several thousand cancers is that every single cancer is unique. If you sequence one cancer genome, you've sequenced one cancer genome. The other person may not be the same as the one you've done. Now, they can fall into common pathways, and in fact, there's about a dozen or so pathways that some groups like. It's probably more than that. These are biochemical pathways that might get genetically altered to cause these cells to grow uncontrollably. Every cancer is unique. And so what people are doing now is they sequence genomes, usually the cancer tissue and the normal, to find these genetic changes that have occurred, and then try and find druggable targets, if you will. I'll walk you through this. So basically, what you would do is you take the cancer cells from a person, you'd harvest the DNA, and you actually sequence it quite deeply, because you try and find, even cancer is actually fairly heterogeneous. You can have, in a tumor, you'll have different genetic changes. You actually sequence deeply, so you can find even rare ones that might be in that tissue. And then you also sequence normal, and you typically try and find these changes, again, that are in druggable targets. And just to show you an example, this is actually the very first one we ever did at Stanford. I think it was done in 2010, where we sequenced an individual with metastatic colon cancer. So colon cancer that's moved to other parts of the body. They did have surgery. We sequenced their DNA. What we discovered was that this is a way of showing how much DNA is there for, in this case, it's on one of the chromosomes. And this region harboring this gene, it's called the EGF receptor gene, it's actually amplified. There are 10 copies instead of two. Okay, actually it's 20 copies, tenfold more in this cancer relative to what there's normally. And there's also another region harboring this gene that's amplified to the same extent. Now, why was this a big deal? Well, in colon cancer, this gene, certainly at the time, was not known to be altered often, having about 2% of patients. Yet this person had this. The reason that was important is there were drugs out there, not for colon cancer, because people didn't think about this being mutated in colon cancer, it was for lung cancer. But there are two drugs that actually target this gene. You're making extra copies of this gene, it's hyperactive, and there are drugs that target it, again, for non-small cell lung carcinoma, different cancer. But we put this individual after surgery on one of these drugs, and as far as we know, they've still been cancer-free. So you can actually then target the specific change, and there's no way we would have known this had we not sequenced their DNA. Okay, it turns out there's a phase 3 drug, I don't think it's still been approved yet, maybe it is out now, for this one, so we have a backup in case something goes wrong. And so the point is there's now getting to be quite a few different drugs against different targets that are often mutated in cancer. There's one of the most famous ones, this one actually hits a particular gene called ABL, and it actually turns out we learn later it's another one. Both of these are often mutated in certain kinds of cancer. And so this is actually the first of the class for these types of drugs. And so the bottom line is that if you have a mutation in these, you'll often get this drug or now some other derivatives that hit the same thing. So the point is you're actually sequencing cancer genomes, finding changes, and actually using drugs to target those. Yeah.
So is that microsatellite DNA? Is that how you get?
No, it's in the case of the EGF receptor, it was a whole region. It's actually fairly large region. Don't remember that one. I think it's about 50,000 bases or 100,000 that was amplified. So it's a big region that amplified up tenfold. Again, it probably got selected for. And so my own belief is that this is going to be standard of care in the future. I can't imagine having cancer and not getting your genome sequenced. Okay, and in fact, I can tell you this has happened in my family now several times, where it started with my mother-in-law who got cancer, I think this was 2000. She had cancer a long time ago, about 20 years later, came back, this is 2012, and started, so, and then suddenly it took off like a shot. So she had ovarian cancer, and her health was just plummeting rapidly. And so it's she was being treated at Sloan Kettering. I can tell you it's the only time in my career, I usually, this is called up her oncologist and said, you know, this is Mike Snyder, chair of genetics at Stanford. It's the only time I've used that. He said, I know you're doing everything possible, but you know, maybe we could help and maybe we could actually sequence her DNA. Now, to show you the Byzantine way this whole system works, they couldn't just give us her cells and things because of all the regulations and IRB approvals. It was a real headache. In fact, we never quite got it, but they agreed to do a bunch of genetic tests. And in fact, she had an alteration in something called a MEK kinase inhibitor. It's one of those biochemical pathways. And there was a phase 3 drug, and she actually took that drug and responded well. So in fact, it helped her. Although 9 months later, her cancer did come back, and that actually happens now in nearly every single one of these cases. So even though these drugs do work, resistance comes back. But just to finish the other part of the story, that, I would argue that 9 months is very valuable because, you know, her health was declining quickly and it gave her a chance to sort of work things out with her daughters, and, you know, it probably was, well, it's phase three drugs, so it's still in trial, to cost us anything, but it will cost a fair amount of money. But I would argue those 9 months were, in that particular situation, was very valuable for our family. And we have other situations like that as well. So again, that was useful, but I don't want to leave you with the idea that we find these targets and we cure. We actually never cure. Resistance always comes back. That's because there's millions of cells that are mutated in cancer, and there's always some resistant cells in there. And so cancer will go the way of AIDS, where you'll actually use multiple drugs to target it. We just don't know the combination yet. That's a very active, highly active area of interest people working. Genome sequencing has also had a huge amount of impact in cancer in other ways. It's been useful for something called immunotherapy. I don't know, have you guys heard this buzzword about immunotherapy at all? It's a whole new form. There's several forms of immunotherapy. One's called checkpoint therapy, where you actually can, cancer cells make a molecule that says, don't eat me. It makes them invisible to the immune system. And one of the forms of immunotherapy is actually to inactivate that don't eat me system, if you will. And that has actually worked really, really well. Actually, I don't know if you know, Jimmy Carter had brain cancer last summer and had metastasized to 4 sites, and he actually went on one of those drugs, a very recent drug, and basically cured him, which is amazing. He's 90 years old. So there's another form where cancer sequencing has had impact. This is a new therapy called vaccination therapy. It's, again, a very high interest area. But what's interesting is that I mentioned that cancer cells, they have these mutations that are drivers. They actually have lots of other mutations. In fact, often cancer cells arise because the repair system in cells is bad. So some cancer will have hundreds of thousands of mutations. Okay, it depends on the cancer. Melanoma tends to have a lot. And in fact, it's actually thought that people are getting cancer all the time in your immune system. They're presenting these mutations can get expressed as proteins that are looking as foreign, and it's thought that normally we call these neoantigens, so these mutations that occur in your DNA probably show up as proteins, and we call them neoantigens, and your immune system will see that and get rid of those cells. And so it's thought that's how we actually keep cancer in check throughout our entire lives. As you get older, your immune system kind of starts going downhill. Whether you like it or not, and basically cancer will come out of that. And so one of this new form of therapy is that you can actually take, again, when cancer, when you get these cancer cells, you sequence DNA, like you say, to find all the variants, and it doesn't matter whether they're driver mutations or not, you also sequence their RNA and figure out which of these neoantigens, these new cancer mutations, are expressed. They can actually vaccinate, just like any old vaccination, they'll use peptides. Now you get little, probably many of you got a flu vaccine last fall, and that's often very specific peptides. So in the case of cancer, what you'll do is you actually, you know which ones are getting expressed, and then you actually you synthesize these as peptides, you actually inject them into the person, you vaccinate them. And it works incredibly well. You start making antibodies to these cancer, and actually another kind of response, probably T cell, is more important. And the net result is that you actually then can, in many cases, I hate to use the word cure because that is a strong word, but you at least cause cancer to go in remission in many cases. So genome sequencing can have an impact in cancer for both predicting drugs and finding new strategies for actually using cancer immunotherapy. So these are some of the things where this new technology is really revolutionized. What's nice about this is I think this will probably be used in combination with standard drug treatments and things as well. You can use combinatoric therapeutics. All right? So the other area where genome sequencing is having huge impact is solving undiagnosed or mystery diseases. So they often call these rare diseases because they'll be diseases that aren't common individually, but in aggregate, they're actually fairly common. So it turns out about 0.4% of children are born each year with some sort of serious health defect. And half the time, you can actually figure it out by just, you know, knowing the kind of defect. It might be a heart failure, you look at certain things, you say, oh, this is what's responsible. But the other half the time, people can't figure it out. So what's happening now is people are turning to genome sequencing to solve these cases. And some of these cases, I'll show you an example in a minute, you know, these kids come out and they have a severe disease, and if the parents have means, they'll take them all over the world to try and find out what's wrong with their child. It can cost millions of dollars, and very severe things happen as well. So again, people are actually turning to genome sequencing. I forgot to say, though, actually it's not just kids when they're, you know, at birth, but during, you know, as kids, people grow, other genetic diseases reveal. You may have heard about cardiomyopathies. They actually often show up in young adulthood because, you know, people are growing fast and their heart doesn't quite warm just right. And so it's estimated quite a few folks have that. And some people say as much as 8% of children and adults have some sort of genetic defect that will manifest itself by adulthood. And that winds up being a lot of people, okay, 25 million. And of course the value of life is extremely high. But the economic value in this system is very high too. It's estimated to be about $5 million per person to deal with one of these untreated diagnostic odysseys. So people, as I say, have turned to genome sequencing to try and solve these cases. And the first successful one is here. This is done by Howard Jacobs, where there was a child who was born. He was healthy until age two, and then all of a sudden all kinds of problems arose. So he got a cut that didn't heal. He started getting more injuries and sepsis, which can have immune issues showing up as well. He wound up having over 100 surgeries, and in fact, he had his entire colon removed. Okay, and his health was plummeting. He was near certain death. Okay, couldn't eat. He was on intravenous feeding, and so the doctor and family turned to genome sequencing. What they found was a mutation in this gene, which is important for immune system development. So it said, aha, all we have to do is replace his immune system. So he got a cord transplant from someone else, and that basically, here we go again, cured him. And he's now eight years old, perfectly healthy. You wouldn't know him any different from any other eight-year-old. And it's all because they sequenced his DNA. So we've done quite a bit of this, as many other groups are doing now. And this is a great success story, but I'll tell you, it fails 70% of the time, 70%. It worked, but it does work 25 to 30% of the time. A very common thing that happens, like the situation here, there's a family we took on. This child here had developmental delay, other issues as well, liver problems, actually all kinds of issues, intellectual issues as well. And so the family turned to us. It's actually one of the first cases we took on, maybe second one. And basically we sequenced the child along with the parents, and I won't get into all the genetic mumbo jumbo, but this is a very typical scenario. You're looking through millions of changes trying to find the one that's responsible for this disease, which is hard when it's something like developmental delay, because there are many ways you could get to that. And at the end we found eight candidates that were there and we were stuck. It's a very common scenario. Well, here's a list of candidates. I have no idea which is the right one. The way this one got solved, it was almost crazy, because there was a second family had similar, they call them characteristics or phenotypes to this one we were studying. And about 10 months after we had solved sequenced this child, they put up the sequence of this one. They thought it was this mutation. There are reasons why you couldn't be 100% sure. But basically, here was a case. These are rare diseases. And this child had a mutation in this one, which is one of the genes on our list, and that's how the match got made. This was put up on a blog. So the way this got solved was by people reading blogs, which, you know, that's crazy, right? What a crazy way to solve disease. So obviously what we need is a common database to be able to share this sort of information. As more and more people go to solve these cases, this would be very, very helpful. And just
to stop supporting the common database now?
Well, no, that's some of the NCBI repositories. This one, they're actually growing out and trying to grow. So, yeah, we can talk about this later, but there are issues about sharing. I can tell you the Well, first of all, let me finish this part. There are now 33 of these kids, because the family we're working with is doing everything it can to try and figure out more about this disease, and we're actually trying to solve this Charles disease. I'm not saying we will. We're making stem cells and things like this that, to be able to answer fairly common, but it shows the power of sharing data, which can be hard to do. And people, and my own view is that the scientists are the worst ones. They like to hoard data. The parents are the best ones. They say they don't care at all about privacy. They want to solve their child. I've never run into a parent that says, no, keep my data private. They want to solve their child at whatever it takes. And so they're happy to share the data, but there are these issues. And I think we're working our way through this, but, and it'll happen. It's kind of happening now.
People like this having trouble getting insurance.
Well, so the answer is no. I mean, they already have an issue. So some of the sequencing actually you can do, insurance companies will pay for it. Especially in a case like this now, not at the time we did it, but now, in some of these cases that are incredibly expensive, insurance companies will pay for it because it saves a lot of money if they figure it out. In other cases, they won't pay for it. And this is, it's an area in flux. As far as that child's insurance, I mean, the family is insured, but we can talk about that later. It's a bigger issue than a healthy issue. And I think one of you, yeah.
What's the core insurance plan?
Oh, it's when, when you moms have babies, they, you know, the placental cord there, the umbilical cord, you can actually have stem cells that are these cells that can regenerate and grow into anything for the most part. And so you can actually take them from someone that most people discard that. You can use those for transplant. You gotta get a proper match with the immune match. Just as a, have any of you done ViaCord or anything like that to save cord cells? A few. I was in the front row, I think. Well, it's worth, we did this when my first child was born. She's almost 15 now. And everybody laughed at me about saving. What do you mean you're saving those cells? That's a joke. You know, there's only a million of them. You'll never be able to do anything with it. But we did it anyway, because you only get one shot. So for those of you who are actually thinking about kids, I have no stock in this area, so I don't know. But actually, we saved, and I'm kind of glad we did. We did it for each of our kids. You have to pay money, it's not free. But you actually said they're a genetic match to actually your child. So, and now we know you can do a lot with these 1 million cells. Back then, people thought that was ridiculous to do anything. So I'm kind of glad we did. That's a little, another editorial comment there. All right. So anyway, just to leave you again, this does work 25, now 30% of the time, the success rate is getting higher. This is an important point, which is we've now done a number of these families, and none of the information has ever been actionable. That is to say, it hasn't helped the child. We might have one now where it might. I mentioned the Nick Volker story where it did help, and there's a few cases like that where it has helped. But it does help families in planning their next child. So many of them are actually turning to IVF, in vitro fertilization, and then you can actually check the embryos to see whether they have those mutations or not, and select embryos then that wouldn't have that. And as much as they tend to like their first child, they prefer not to have another child with the same genetic defect. So that is how many families are using. And minimally, I can tell you, even if they don't do that, everybody is happy to know the cause of their kid in every single case we've solved. Because there are all these odysseys. Again, some of them literally traveling all over the world to try and solve their child, to be finally able to tell, well, here's what's wrong with your child. Even if you can't do anything about it, at least you know what the problem is. Okay? And that is reassuring to people. I'll move quickly into this one. So this is an area that has interested us for quite some time, because we were thinking, you know, you talk about, all of you get asked when you go to a doctor, so, you know, what runs in your family, diabetes or schizophrenia, what have you? What's your family history? And that is a big part of healthcare. How many of you are physicians here, by the way? A few, yeah. So, right? So, family history is a big part of healthcare. So, one of the things we wanted to test, and at the time this was incredibly controversial, was 2009, is whether sequencing genomes might be useful for healthcare. And specifically, could getting your DNA sequence be able to be used to help predict disease, diagnose disease early, maybe monitor disease once you get it, and possibly help treat disease in the fashions I've mentioned before? And you wouldn't do this in a vacuum. You would use other information, for example, family history, or whatever medical information you have, which, you know, for biochemical tests, it's rather limited, and you get other physiological measures like, you know, heartbeat and blood pressure, things like that. So you bring all this information to be able to better do this. Now, I was at Yale a long time, and 6 years ago, I moved to Stanford, and we've been thinking about this for some time, but really hit home when I moved there, and of course, I wrote a new health plan, and they gave me back my blood results with these 20 things, and I thought, why the heck are we only measuring 20 things? Because we have the capability of measuring thousands, if not tens of thousands of things. So we decided we would measure every single molecule we could possibly measure from people, okay? That is to say, in addition to determining our DNA sequence, we would actually determine our modified DNA. It's called the epigenome, and it's very heavily influenced by the environment. In our case, again, this is for the aficionados, we follow something called DNA methylation, the modified DNA, which is influenced by your exercise, your nutrition, all kinds of things in mysterious ways you don't fully understand. But we also measure, this will sound like mumbo jumbo to some of you, but we also measure all your RNA. It's actually the messenger that comes from your gene. We measure all your proteins, it's called the proteomes. These are transcriptome here. We miss some of the rare ones with the technology we use, it's called mass spectrometry. So we actually have specific assays to follow very important immune molecules called cytokines that regulate your immune system. We've been really trying to optimize metabolomics. We spend a lot of time on both blood and urine. I should say all these come from blood components, either your immune cells in the blood or something called your plasma, which is your fluid in the blood, which is essentially it's your, you know, it's your river that carries nutrients, but it's also your garbage can where a lot of stuff shows up. And so we actually measure as many metabolites as possible using something called untargeted. They have experts here, Ed and others are experts in this area as well. And we optimize this for getting untargeted metabolomics for both blood and urine. I should say we don't even know how many metabolites. So metabolites are like the food you eat and things like this. We don't even know how many metabolites are in a human being, how many are useful. We also have arrays that let you follow your antibody reactivity. We can put all of the effectively protein sequences that we have on a microscope slide along with all the common viruses. We actually can figure out your reactivity to those viruses right on one probing, if you will. And these days, we also follow five different microbiomes. So gut, urine, nasal, tongue, and skin. I'll explain this in a minute. These are the microbes that live in and on you. And so there are millions of them. Well, sorry, thousands of them. So initially, we didn't have this. We didn't have this. We were following about 40,000 molecules. Some of these assays were primitive. And now we literally make billions of measurements every time we sample someone. Okay, we're making out of their blood, out of their urine, and then the microbe from various parts. Now, when we launched this study, because it was a bit controversial, a lot of people were scared about genome sequencing, thinking, well, you're going to learn all these bad things, and that may not be a good thing to do. So we wanted to find someone who wouldn't mind and also would be accessible, and of course, as you probably guessed, that person was me. And I didn't have to worry about suing myself if something went wrong, everything was basically hunky-dory. So, and it really was, I didn't know I'd be interested. It really was a proof of principle to get this whole thing set up. And I can tell you we're now following, you'll see in a minute, 100 people, and everybody's interesting, and not just to their mother. Scientifically interesting. All right, so when we started the study, it so happens I had let me say that we've been doing this now for almost 6 years. March will be 6 years. Thinking about 180 time points. I've been through 8 viral infections and Lyme disease, actually, during this time. Okay, and the day we started, I had a rhinovirus. These are all common colds, all these viral infections. I've never had influenza, I think because of herd immunity. My family members get vaccinated, and I've only done it once. I have to profile myself if I get vaccinated and follow these things. So that's been harder to arrange. But anyway, I've been through all these viral infections. Again, these are rhinovirus, the ones in purple. And you see when we started, that was day 0. Each of these is a day, 4 days, 21 days. And then for the most part, what we do is we take samples roughly every 2 to 3 months when I'm healthy. I'll come to some of this later. And then when I have one of these viral infections, we weren't quite as well prepared there. We sample a lot. So for this one, see, as soon as I get congested, we take blood that day, next day, 2 days, 2 days, 3 days. Very dense sampling when sick. And every 2 to 3 months I'm healthy, an interesting time to before and after Malaysia, things like this that would be might be of interest to follow. And so we've been, again, doing this now for almost 6 years. I've been putting myself through various dietary perturbations right now. So I'm sampling quite a bit, and that's what a lot of these are, because I want to see what my diet does to my biochemistry. And I'm going to summarize a lot of this, but we started by sequencing my DNA, which made many predictions about my susceptibility to disease. Now, in my case, most of what we learned I already knew. So that is to say, this is something called a riskogram. This is for the aficionados for complex disease. But for hundreds of diseases, for those of you who have done 23andMe, it's kind of like this, although we're doing whole genome. It's much more supercharged. For hundreds of diseases, you can predict risk. We match this to the ethnic groups in the European male ethnic and sex group. I have a 100% chance of getting these diseases here, 0% there. The triangle is my starting point. And this orangish line means increased risk, blue line means decreased risk. And so my risk actually matched what I knew pretty darn well. That is to say, everyone in my family, going back to my great grandparents, has never been overweight. I'm a decreased risk for that. I have high triglycerides and cholesterol, and I'm on statins. I'm a great responder. And that shows up here, so lipid misregulation. So we can see that in my genome. Everyone on my father's side has either died of something with heart issues that was never always sorted out, but heart failure, either associated with coronary artery disease or what have you. And he has a big family, nine brothers and sisters who lived to adult. All of them, including my dad, died of one of these related genes, so I'm at increased risk there. That all made sense. But there were some surprises. And this one showed up kind of late in the study, whereas you see, big risk for basal cell carcinoma, and I was not aware of that in my family history. But about 3 years ago, we had a family reunion. And so I had two brothers and two sisters. One sister didn't come to visit, and that's when we took blood from all of them. So we I just happened to mention the two brothers and one sister. What do you know about basal cell carcinomas? Because I saw it in my genome, and they said, actually they each had lesions for these. So in fact, it was in my family history, I didn't know it. And so what I like to say is that your genome is a better record of your family history than your family is. And the reason for that is the information transfer is rather poor, right? You don't talk about basal cell carcinomas around the dinner table, at least we don't mine. So I had no idea. If you know how to interpret it, the information is there. And I do find it ironic that people are scared of genome sequences, but they're perfectly comfortable with family history because that's much lower resolution and poorer. And maybe that's why they like it, because it's not as certain. None of this is certain either. It's kind of like family history to keep an eye out for these things. And by the way, I got something called a keratosis, which is up here in my head last summer, which you can just take it right off and sequence it, which I did. And it's thought to be a precursor for basal cell carcinoma, so it kind of puts you on the alert for these. And then the other part of the story, again, some of you may know this, we learned this very early, it's very high risk for type 2 diabetes, which surprised me. I was not aware of that from my family history. Although in hindsight, maybe some of it was there, I just didn't realize it. And I remember we're measuring millions of things on me, including glucose. We're measuring a lot of standard medical molecules as well. And we have been following my glucose, it had been marching along perfectly normally. And because of my genome, I went in for a very fancy glucose metabolism test, and the woman looks at me and says, there's no way to type 2 diabetes, because you don't look it, and you don't have a family history. And I said, well, I sequenced my genome, and I really want to see if I might have something there. And so we did this very fancy glucose metabolism test. And even before we started, this was this day here, I came out high, we were both shocked, so she repeats it. It beats high. This is my fasted glucose, again, for the aficionados. Measured it a week later, even higher. And this is a better measure for steady-state glucose called hemoglobin A1C. It's glycosylated hemoglobin. And it's arbitrary, but diabetic is called 6.5. And I came out at 6.4. I'm smack on the edge. Okay. And so, obviously, that raised my eyebrows. I went to my general practitioner, so I didn't know anything about type 2 diabetes. And she looks at me and says, no way, they got it all wrong. Just, you don't look it, there's no way you can have type 2 diabetes. That was 5 weeks later, this is here, so we took the blood test, went to know, even higher, 6.7, classified as diabetic. I can tell you when that was. That was April 11, 2011. Why do I know? I had the world's worst diet up to then. I ate plenty of cakes and soda, lemonade, because I didn't know I had a sugar problem. So I cut all that out, and cold turkey, and I had been biking, but I cut out all the excuses. I doubled my biking, and I started running. And this isn't fast. It's about 8 months. I actually finally got under control. So this made a big splash at the time because it's the first time someone used their genome to predict their risk for a disease. And in my case, actually, I was able to manage the disease, at least temporarily, as you'll see in a minute. It's also quite interesting when it occurred. You'll notice it occurred right after this viral infection. This is called respiratory syncytial virus. This is common in kids, not that common in adults. Although when adults get this, they get pretty sick. And that was true for me. I was out for a couple of days. And so the hypothesis is that my genome has been predisposed for type 2 diabetes, and then in conjunction with this viral infection or the stress associated with it, that's what triggered the disease. So viruses have been associated with type 1, not type 2. So this is new turf, if you will. And so that is our hypothesis, not proven. But I can tell you anecdotally, after the story came out, we've got lots of people with very similar comments. It's not real science. But they've been in very similar situations where a viral infection has led them or a family member to get type 2 diabetes. So, lest you think this is a happy ending, it's not fully gone away. We wound up doing, by accident, the right control. So, as we scale, so some people say, Mike, that would have gone away on its own. Okay? They didn't do all the running and biking, mind you. But anyway, we did the right control because that when we scaled to 100 people, you'll see in a minute, we're now doing 100 people. And basically, what happened was we were still collecting all the data, all the samples, but nobody was looking at the results because they're so busy getting all these other samples in. And so what happened was I stopped running, and I had actually, well, let's get that. It was right here. Is when somebody finally looked at my glucose and hemoglobin A1C, actually looked at hemoglobin A1C, said, Mike, you realize you're 7.0 on hemoglobin A1C? I said, no, I had no idea. In fact, I've been diabetic. In fact, I've been elevated for about a year without even realizing it. So I did the perfect control. I sampled me a few times, started running, and I can bring it down. I got it to 5.7. It's now around 6.1. It actually went to 6.5 when I got Lyme disease. So I do have a glucose misregulation problem, no question. And it's not only me, it's my whole family. My brothers and sisters, two are skinnier than me. We all are pre-diabetic. My brothers and sisters are all in this 5.7 to 6.2 range. And there's no way you would have guessed without this genome sequencing that we would have been at risk for this. So I would argue for our family, it's helped a lot. And so I may wind up going on metformin because I'm at higher levels of sugar than I'd like to be. I am playing with diet to see if I can get it under control in other ways. I don't know if it'll work, but we'll see. Okay. So that's where we are. Again, no question, metabolic disorder. And so that's actually that first spike. That's the 8 month or 10 month spike, and this is the new one. So I don't know what triggered it here. I was starting to say I stopped running, as you might imagine. I started again here. It's the one thing that's actually seems to help a lot in this. Had a rhinovirus analysis, switched that. So it could be any of those three. We've gotten a little bit late, so I won't spend much time, but by looking at all my molecules in my blood, we get an IMAX movie, if you will, of the changes that are occurring when I get these diseases. When I get a viral infection, we see my immune system goes ballistic. That's not a surprise, although we see some interesting other stuff, too. This is during the time I got type 2 diabetes. I can see biochemical pathways changing. We had to write very sophisticated algorithms to be able to pull this out. In an unbiased fashion. And my insulin biosynthetic pathway has dropped, for example, during the time I got type 2 diabetes. I can tell you, on average, my insulin's never been the same as it was on average before that viral infection. So it's dropped somewhat. And I have other issues that have popped up as well during this time. So you can actually see, again, very interesting biochemical changes occurring when people get disease. I might just say this because I have got behind. But you probably know, I'll maybe summarize quickly. So you've maybe, have you heard about the microbiome? How many of you? Everybody's heard about the microbiome. It's not just the front row either. Good. All right. So you probably know you have 10 times as many cells in and on you that aren't you than are you. That's bacteria and other things, and there are Seth and others here are studying this. It's a very fascinating area. It's absolutely critical for your health. It helps you digest your food, makes essential vitamins that are very complicated, B12, that would be hard to synthesize chemically. And these days, it's implicated in every single disease you can imagine, but what's cause and effect isn't always so clear. But the ones I've listed here are pretty clear. So inflammatory bowel disease, diabetes, obesity, and even heart attacks, the actual links between your microbiome and those diseases is quite strong. And I can tell you that we actually have one mystery time. I'll just jump to the punchline here. When we added the microbiome, which we've been doing for about 4 years now, we're looking at this in detail. We started with one very interesting, maybe I will tell you, it's a fun story. So during this viral infection, it started out as a rhinovirus, but about 9 or 11 days later, a second fever came, and I took all kinds of swabs to figure out what was wrong. And I couldn't figure out, we couldn't find the virus or anything. So we were kind of stuck. But when we started doing the microbiome, remember we're doing my nasal and stool and other parts. First one we did was, in fact, this mystery infection. So basically, here's when I was healthy, here's the mystery infection. Here's 2 days later, 2.5 days later, back to healthy. And we sequenced the organisms there, if you will. And there's many diseases here. I'm just showing the top of the list. But this organism correlated perfectly with when I got sick. And it turns out it's Streptococcus pneumonia. So the odds are I had a strep infection. And this is the world's most expensive way to figure this out. But it's a nice proof of principle. I still find it amazing that if you get sick, and we don't know, right? Every symptom is flu, it's never influenza. We just ignore this and we move on. But I think it's crazy because it's not that expensive, right? The only time you figure it out is when people, it doesn't clear up, but like mono, and then it's too late. They've spread it to a whole bunch of other people. So if you think about it, we should actually be scoring this stuff right as it comes along in real time. So if somebody has mono, you don't wait until they hit 50 other kids. You get it right then and there. And there's no reason we can't do that kind of stuff in today's technology. I've gotten behind, but we're also very big on wearables. You may have heard about there's 1,000 wearable devices now on the market. 500 are related to health. And I use 9 of these devices every day. I have 3 smartwatches. Radiation monitor, I have other things. I have a continuous glucose monitor. I know exactly what foods do what to my glucose levels. So when I eat a banana, I know exactly how it's going to go off on my glucose and other things that I didn't realize. And it differs from person to person. So these are the sorts of things you can figure out. And all this information relays smack into your iPhone, okay? With 1 or 2 exceptions. So we just need to integrate the information. You can get electrocardiogram right on your iPhone. So this is going to be your health nexus of the future. We need to get the biochemical information moving in here as well. Because it's gotten late, I'll just tell you that actually these wearables were invaluable for me when I got Lyme disease, because that's actually how I figured it out. My oxygen had dropped, because I measure myself so much. My oxygen had dropped, my heart rate went up, my skin temperature went up, and I knew something wasn't quite right, and then I got a low-grade fever. And in the end, I figured out it was Lyme disease. You may say, well, that's no big deal. It was a big deal because it was Norway at the time. Well, I got it in the U.S. And, you know, the Norwegian doctor recommended penicillin, and I actually had to say, well, I think I need doxycycline. And had I gone penicillin, it could have been serious consequence. Clear right up until I took doxycycline. So I would argue, again, this is going to be valuable information. This is the future. This plus other things will feed smack into your health system. All right, I could wrap up, I guess. Should I wrap up? You want 5 more minutes?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. All right, it's not just me. This works for other people. We sequence a family of 4, and you might find this controversial, but the father, the teenage daughter, had a factor 5 mutation, which means they're susceptible to blood clots, and that actually affected the birth control of the daughter. We also sequenced 12 healthy people, and one woman in this study actually had a BRCA1 mutation, which puts her extremely high risk for breast and ovarian cancer. No question it's an activating mutation. No family history, so she only learned about it from her genome. And because of this, she opted for surgery, which she would, again, not have known had she not done this. Now I'm saying you have to have surgery, but I would argue this information is very valuable to have. And so again, that came out in the study. We're now studying 100 people just like me. Where we're actually sampling them every 3 months when they're healthy, trying to understand what it means for them to be healthy. And then basically what happens when they go through these stress responses, either viral infections, we've had 2 people up 48 hours, we sample them after that time. Various people are going through dietary changes, I might mention some of this tomorrow, they either do a weight gain study or they're doing a diet, because we're trying to understand exactly what foods do what to people's health. And just to give you a few vignettes, here's a good example from the first group we studied so far. Again, very useful information. A woman with a mutation in this gene puts a very high risk for this, and she never would have known it had we not sequenced her DNA, paraganglioma. And there's a simple urine test she'll have to do which she can do every year to see if she has. This is an issue. But she'll be able to catch this early now because of this. Recently, we just solved, there's someone in our study said, Mike, my father had a heart attack at a fairly young age, early 60s, and everyone, a lot of males in his family all had heart attacks, age 50 to 60. And so we looked into his DNA, and sure enough, he had a mutation that puts him at a very high risk. It's probably the cause of early heart attacks in his family. And so we not only figure out the cause, but we figure out he has the mutation, and he is at risk, so he has to actually watch himself. And in fact, he is about to go on drugs to keep his heart under control. One of the big lessons that come out of this, and I won't get into this because it has gotten late, is that we've discovered that every person, this is kind of known already, but not at the level we've seen, every person is different. That is to say, your baseline healthy state is not the same for any one of you. And this just shows these important immune molecules called cytokines. The levels will vary from one person to another. Every color is a different person. This person, for example, is high for this particular one. The blue person's high for that one. So on and so forth. People have different levels, baseline levels of these things, which probably explains why, you know, I got sick twice a year when my kids were little. You saw the data there. My wife got sick once in this whole period. She's got clearly a better immune system somehow and is able to fight things off. Is your microbiome, everybody's microbiome, we didn't discover this, everybody's microbiome is unique. But what we found is that actually when you go through perturbations like weight gain or viral infections, it will shift, but you still look more like you than anyone else. That is to say, our microbiome is robust to short-term perturbations, although I think there's evidence that it can change with long-term perturbations, like diet changes from long-term will shift it, but short-term we'll do this. So this is really the goal of all this study. We're trying to understand how people, when faced with certain stimuli, say some people eat badly and they get overweight and get diabetes, and other people eat the same thing perfectly healthy. There are plenty of obese people who are not diabetic, actually. They're perfectly healthy. Why is that? We don't know. Probably some of it is their DNA. And it's not just good enough to say it's in their genes. We want to understand why it's in their genes. Also, people who get viral perturbations, I'm a good example. I got diabetes after my viral perturbation. Plenty of people get RSV and don't have this. Presumably, again, I'm genetically predisposed and I see this. So this is what I see as the future. This is Mike Snyder's future. I'm not saying it's everyone's. I think we will see a world where people get their genome sequenced before birth. We can talk about how that information is returned. We'll bring in other kinds of these detailed molecular measurements with wearable device and smart data to be able to feed into our iPhone and tell us when we're, we'll use genome for predicting risk and use this information to be able to diagnose and catch disease early. So the summary of all this is that genome sequencing is here. How many of you want to get your genome sequenced now? Okay. How many don't want to get their genome sequenced?
Oh,
I love that. Maybe I have a little bit of an effect. First time ever. And how many don't know still? But it's something you have to think about because it is an option for you. It will be an option for you unless for some fortuitous reason you pass away in the next few years, because it will be affordable for everyone. But I do think these are the most important parts of this. I do think this other information is valuable for finding disease. But the biggest part of this whole thing is the longitudinal part. That is to say, we all have a different healthy state. And when you get disease, you want to see your altered state relative to your own healthy state, not relative to everybody else's. That's impossible to interpret. You want to see how you shift and change so you can catch disease early and manage it accordingly. And that's not going to happen unless you're following yourself. And so I would argue we need to get these healthy profiles now. Get them while you're healthy so you can see when you shift. And I do think, you know, there's a lot of these what are called triplet repeat diseases, fragile X1, and there are others as well. And yeah, there are issues associated. I think I'll just jump. I hate to shortchange it, but we have a lot of wonderful collaborators who actually did all the work. And I'm going to make one last shameless plug here, two last shameless plugs. So we're actually, if you like this kind of area, you want to learn more, we're actually running an online class that you can take. It's called a certificate program at Stanford to teach you more. This is a little bit more for people who want to dig in. It's a certificate program. They run out of a professional school that actually runs exactly in this space. And here's my second shameless plug, which is a this book literally is just coming out now. And this is written for the layperson. You can read this in about 2 hours, I think, maybe three. It's meant to be an easy read. You can tell me if I got it right. But you can learn more about this here as well. So anyway, that's what I wanted to say. Thanks again for having me here. Sorry to run a little bit.